Alright. This is Gary, and he will be presenting SELinux for Dummies.
Okay. Thank you all for coming. This is SELinux for Dummies. And yes, if you would. As I mentioned before, if you go Googling for a book called SELinux for Dummies, you won't find one. I think this is a great marketing disadvantage on the part of the Dummy Books Corporation. So, and judging by as many people as are in this room, I would say that there's probably a real demand for such a book. I thought I would start out a little bit differently and do the demo first. And then go into the slides. So, I have a system here running CentOS 6.4, and I have a plain vanilla user here who, if you're listening to our Doctor Who discussion, you know that the master is the master of evil. So he has gotten a program off of the internet to do nasty things. And I'm going to be looking at that and typing here, which is going to be a real trick. However, am I in the right place? Yes.
You do know that none of us can actually see that, right?
Oh.
Is it bigger?
That's as big as it gets.
Apple Shift Plus, bigger or
smaller?
Oh, what's that? I'll take suggestions if anybody's got it. I'm making it bigger.
You can make the terminal font bigger.
Can't you just do Control Plus?
No, not on a MacBook.
Shift Plus, okay.
No, Apple. The Apple iPhone is Shift Plus.
Nope.
Edit preferences.
Pull on the corner of it.
Let's see. Edit.
Profile preferences.
Profile preferences.
Uncheck use the system font.
Oh, yeah.
Uncheck use the system font.
And then change that something bigger.
Yep. 72.
72. Hey, let's try 24. That's probably a good bet.
That's great.
Okay, close. Oh, hey. All right. This is a program that the master has gotten off of the internet to do bad things, and he runs it. And now, who am I? Well, we'll do this instead. Oh boy, I'm Root. I can do anything I like. I can do all kinds of nastiness. That's the master. That's the way he does things. He does all sorts of nasty stuff. But he started out as the master. So the master does all sorts of nasty stuff, and he leaves. He's getting away. Well, in the meantime, the system administrator has seen and suspects that the master is doing nasty stuff. So, if I can type right, nope.
You got the O in
there. It is a poor typist that can only find one way to type a word. Okay.
That's good.
Now, at some point in time, the master comes back and he's ready to do more evil. So he runs his little program. Boom. No such luck. The master's been thwarted. How did he get thwarted? The system administrator turned SELinux on. This little program does stack smashing. Puts code out there, executes it, becomes root. This is one of the many ways that SELinux can make your system safer. Okay. Now, let's go to the slides. Bingo! Okay. In case you missed it, I'm Gary Smith. One of my many titles is Information System Security Officer, and I work at the Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, which is a DOE-sponsored lab in Richland, Washington. And here we have some of our happy researchers doing wonderful things, bending molecules, making the world safe for science. We have a rather large supercomputer there. We're getting ready to get rid of that one and get a larger one in terms of actual capabilities. My job is securing that supercomputer and all of its infrastructure. But that's not what we're here to talk about today. We're here to talk about SELinux. To provide a little bit of context, cybersecurity is all about basically one thing: managing risk. How do you manage the risk involved with your supercomputers, your infrastructure, your PCs, whatever? There are lots of books that will tell you about how to think about managing that risk. I like to think about how you manage computer security risk by what I call the five golden principles of security. And why are there five? Why come there's not seven or nine or three or something? In an engineering class I had in college, the professor said that the average human mind can keep up with five things, so that's why five. These are not something I came up with. The only thing I will take credit for is this particular order. The reason why it makes it easy is that no is at the top and the bottom, the central concept is in the middle, and numbers 2 and 4 both start with P. Okay, know your system. Know what runs on it. Know what your network is like. What is your traffic? Principle of least privilege. Don't give users, processes, managers, CIOs, CEOs, whatever, don't give them more privilege than they absolutely need to do their job. Defense in depth is the centralized concept of the whole thing. That's the nucleus. Don't just do one thing to secure your system. Do multiple things in a ring sort of structure like you have trees. Protection is key, but detection is a must. You can harden systems all day long, but if you don't know that something has gone wrong, you've lost the battle. The last one, know your enemy. Know what tools he uses, know what tricks he uses. That comes right out of Sun Tzu. Today, principally, we're talking about the principle of least privilege. That's what SELinux gives you. As a result of using SELinux, I guarantee you of two things. One is you will know your system a lot better. As a result, you will find out how bad some of the software on your system is written. I have some examples of that. And this is all part of defense in depth. It's one of the many things that you can do. A little bit of history. Operating systems started out with discretionary access control, DAC. That's what we're all familiar with. Read, write, execute. User group, other. We know how that works pretty well. In a DAC operating system, the users get to set the permissions on the files to whatever they like. One of the constant problems is users setting things to read, write, execute by everybody. This is not very good security practice. And the kernel just makes the decisions of what is allowed based on these access controls that anybody can change as they own their own files. So, come on. Next slide. Down. Don't you love computers? Well, Let's try that. Ah, success. Ain't technology grand. What could go wrong with this system? Okay, Apache. Apache's a good whipping boy. Apache runs on lots of systems. And what if somebody comes up with a exploit for Apache or one of its many modules that allows it to run as root, and then it starts snarfing Etsy shadow, Etsy password, whatever. Not good. Another example. I run the Nessus scanner back at my place of work to do vulnerability assessment of what's running on systems and what vulnerabilities may be there. Now, back in the old days of version 3 Nessus, that was just a daemon out there, and you ran a client program that you would tell it, okay, go off and do these systems at this particular time of day. Well, they've gotten much more sophisticated now, and it has a web interface built into it. Well, it uses Flash and it uses HTML5. What's to say that there's not a vulnerability in that small HTTP daemon built into it and some Flash vulnerability, and somebody can exploit my Nessus scanner, and now they can do all sorts of damage by running all sorts of unsafe tests against my systems, or they could just download the report files from my scans and see, oh gee, all of these systems here, and they have these particular vulnerabilities that haven't been remediated. Lots of things can go wrong. Our basic security model is a little bit too simplistic. We don't have an effective way of ensuring least privilege, although we have tried lots of other things. A system that I was intimately familiar with in another life as a roving consultant expanded on the idea of the privileges. Instead of having just read, write, and execute, they expanded it to read, write, execute, and delete, and they added a fourth group of the system user. That was okay, but it's still the same problem. Users can set permissions incorrectly. They can also configure applications incorrectly. We've tried other things like chroot jails. Well, that's another way of making things have less privilege, but we need something better than that. One possibility is SELinux. SELinux goes beyond just mere DAC, Discretionary Access Control. Processes and resources have had some extra vitamins laid on them to give them a finer granularity. SELinux implements what's called Mandatory Access Control, or MAC. And unfortunately, I think this is a sad name to choose for this, because anything that's got an Ethernet card and it's got a MAC, Media Access Control. I've got an Apple here, and it's a Mac. So we've got Mac, and Mac. Wonderful. But a Mac architecture, Mandatory Access Control, enforces that idea, principle of least privilege, by using a security policy over the files of the system. It is not left to the user to make the decisions on access. That has been taken away. Now, the way this is usually implemented is there's some sort of mandatory access control engine implemented inside the kernel. It uses a policy to make those decisions based on extra properties that have been given to processes, files, directories, pipes, FIFOs, sockets, you name it. Okay, where does this magic policy come from?
Dan Walsh.
Dan Walsh, exactly. Dan Walsh. Face the east about three times. Whatever. Okay, get the count right. By the way, there are two large problems in computer science. One, cache invalidation. Two, naming things. Three, off by one errors. Okay, the policy comes from the same place as whoever has the permissions on files. It comes from the vendor. And probably it came from Dan Walsh by way of the by way of that. What's the difference between Mac and DAC? Okay, in DAC, we said that files, decisions on access are based on those permissions in the files. Every user can set those permissions however they like, however wrong that may be. So consequently, malicious, flawed, or misconfigured software, and heaven only knows we don't have any misconfigured software. If you've ever looked at how hard it is to set up Apache, you know this is the case. That can end up with things getting controls that they shouldn't have. It's also rather easy if an application is said UID or said GID to have some sort of exploit in it that it can be taken advantage of. Mac does not have these problems. It is a whole layer above that. And although this is somewhat true, the system administrator can set the security policy on all of these files and objects. And there. Okay. Processes and files and the way processes interact with each other. This is all controlled by that kernel security policy monitor. Decisions by that policy is all based on the rules in the policy. And it's not just based on how that user is logged in. Mac gives you incredibly fine-grained control over users, programs, processes, files, directories, devices, sockets, FIFOs, you name it.
After telling us there were three Macs, which Mac are we talking about?
Ah, a good point. This is Mac, mandatory access control.
Okay.
Yeah, I was trying to be cute with Mac versus DAC SmackDown. I guess WWF was on the TV at the time as I was making this one. But yes, this is mandatory access control, not media access control or Mac from Apple. Okay. What are the benefits of SELinux? All processes and files have a label associated with them. We'll talk a little bit more about that. Okay. We'll talk about what domains are, but it's a separation, that idea of the principle of least privilege. These SELinux rules define how the processes are going to interact with other processes, how files will be accessed and interacted with them. Significant point to bring up here, the default policy for SELinux is don't allow. It is deny. So consequently, when you start doing any kind of writing of policy, it's always allow this, allow this, allow this, allow this. The default thing to do is deny. This is what I call the German prisoner of war camp. If you've ever seen Hogan's Heroes, you know Sergeant Schultz is up there going, "Colonel Hogan, that is strictly forbidden." Well, that's the same idea here. It's strictly forbidden. You've got to be allowed it to get access to it. It gives us very fine-grained control. And I have some examples of how fine-grained that control is. The policy is set across the whole system. So, SE Linux comes in four flavors, at least that I know of. The one you're most likely to see is this one called the Targeted Environment, or TE. If you install Red Hat or CentOS or Fedora, straight out of the box, you get the Targeted Environment. Another one is Strict. Strict is sort of like Targeted Environment on steroids. It's much more restrictive. Role-based access control, or RBAC, is another form of SE Linux policy. What that does is that defines roles for users. For instance, you may have a system administrator role. You may have an operator role. You might have a backup operator role. You might have a security administrator role. This increases the separation that you can get. For instance, the system administrator role may be able to start and shut down processes, but only the security administrator role is able to change the security policy. And then there's MLS, multi-level security. A good example of what multi-level security is let's take a simple case of a system with unclassified, secret, and top secret. That's an example of a multi-level security system. And if you've ever worked on an MLS system, you know it can be very interesting. For instance, an MLS system that I was working on at one point in time, if you were at the secret level and there was a process running at top secret that was sucking up all the CPU, you know something is wrong with the system because it's running slowly, but you can't see that process. That's how fine-grained some MLS systems go. MLS also has a cousin called MCS, multi-category system, where you've categorized users into sort of groups, like for instance accounting or finance or marketing or research and development. Okay. But what SE Linux is not, it is not a substitute for firewalls. It is not a substitute for antivirus. It is not an all-in-one security solution. It is part of that defense in depth that you get of doing multiple things to secure your system. It would be nice if we had an all-in-one security solution. We don't. If somebody asked me, can you characterize SE Linux very succinctly? And I say, yes, I can characterize it in one word. That is labeling. SE Linux is all about labeling. Everything in SE Linux has a label. Processes, files, you name it. Everything has a label.
Users
have labels. SE Linux is basically just a label engine. It puts labels on stuff according to a series of rules, and it makes decisions based on those labels. So, unfortunately, we sometimes use the word label and context in the same context. Yeah. But they are synonymous, okay? In SE Linux parlance, jargon, subjects are processes. And directories, sockets, FIFOs, all of those are objects. So subjects interact with objects. Fortunately, the people that thought up SE Linux did not carry on this English paradigm further. So there are no verbs, adjectives, prepositions, or whatever in SE Linux. Maybe there should be. Maybe it would be interesting to have a subject with an adjective attached to it, operating on an object with an adverb. But fortunately, SE Linux was created by engineers and not English majors.
I think we'd be using stupid way too much as an adverb.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Yeah, we'd be using stupid a whole lot. Okay. Subjects and objects. A subject is a process, and an object is a file or something that abstracts to a file. This idea of a context has a different name attached to it depending on what it's associated with. If it's a file or something that abstracts to a file, something rather static on disk, it's called a context. If it's associated with a process which is pretty dynamic, it's called a domain. Yeah, I know. Okay. What makes up this context? What does a label really look like? Well, it's either three or four components and they're separated by colons. Three or four? Well, yeah. Now, I'm going to do two things differently at this point, because usually at this point, people who talk about SE Linux, they usually throw up some graphic or the other that shows how SE Linux works in the kernel. If I did that, your eyes would bleed. I'm not going to do that. Another thing that they usually do at this point is they usually start at the left and work to the right on the context. I'm not going to do that either. I'm going to start at the right and work to the left, because that gets us to where the rubber meets the road much quicker. And hopefully you've been here for about half an hour and it's getting warm in here and you're probably had a big lunch and you're probably about ready to fall asleep. So, this is what a context looks like. Starting at the right, this is the level. Remember I was talking about multi-level security. This is the level. And it's usually, if you expand it out and you're working in a true multi-level system, it will be something like S0, it ranges from S0 to S15, or C0 to C1023, which gives you a lot of possibilities. Generally speaking, unless you are using the sandbox feature of SE Linux to run a... Oh dear. Okay.
SE Linux shut down your presentation.
Yeah. Okay, maybe I just wasn't interacting with it enough. Hello. Okay, there we are. Nope. Maybe I wasn't typing enough on the keyboard. That sometimes happens. Ain't technology grand? I love it when technology works. Okay, generally speaking, you won't see this level unless you're using the sandbox feature to run a process in a sandbox. And what it does is that it generates this level on the fly. Here's where the rubber meets the road, the type. This is what you see most often in this. It's what you're really concerned with, because this is the type. This is why it's called targeted enforcement or type enforcement. The role is what you usually see in RBAC. Usually that's just filled in with something. And the user is the SE Linux user, but we really don't have to worry about that too much. Type is what we're interested in. So here's a sample context. This is not one I made up. This is actually the context for etsyresolve.conf on a RHEL 6.4 system. Now, there are many ways to read this. I will tell you the way I read it so that it penetrates my brain what is actually going on. Show you the right way first, and then I'll tell you the wrong way, how not to do it. You read this, or at least I'd read this, as system user, object, role, netconf, type, and then I skip that. The reason I read it that way is by saying system user. Oh, that is a system, the user system. Object, role. It's an object, the role is object. netconf type. The type is network configuration. If you read this as just a bunch of English words straight across, system U, object R, netconf T, it won't mean anything to you. If you're going to do this, train yourself to enunciate inside your head or vocally. You know, there's no problem if you have to move your lips while you're reading. Enunciate what that is, user, role, type, so that it sticks inside your head and stays with you. Now, how did I get this context? Is that just something that's hidden from me? No, it's not. There's an option to display what the context is of files, processes, and all sorts of things on the system. And the problem comes down to, what option do I use to display this? Well, somebody did some research and they found out that dash capital Z was not, forward. They found out that dash capital Z is not used by any other Linux or Unix utilities. So dash Z is how you see the context of things. So for instance, if I did ls-cap-z on a file or a directory, I would see the context of the files. If I did ps-efz, I would see my standard listing of what I expect the processes to be. But out there, it would also show me what the context, the security context of all the processes were running. If I wanted to see what my own context is, ID-Z, that will show me what my context is. The really great thing about SE Linux is that by and large, except for a very few cases, applications and programs did not have to recompile in order to take advantage of it. Well, isn't that great? That's great. If SE Linux decides that a process does not have access to a particular file, the error that's returned is no access. They didn't have to recompile the program to take advantage of some new SE Linux return codes. It still gets the return code that it should be able to deal with. There aren't very many programs that have to be SE Linux aware, which is really good. Obviously, some of them got to be like part of the core utilities. PS, LS, find. You can find, use the find command to find files on your system with a particular SE Linux context. Programs that had to set the context as a result of, say, a user logging in. Those had to be made SE Linux aware. Like, for instance, login, SSHD, GDM, cron. Cron runs programs on your behalf, so it had to be made SE Linux aware. Okay, I see everybody's starting to nod off. All right, one word that describes SE Linux is? Excellent. Great. We're doing good. All right. Some core programs to manipulate the SE Linux context had to get made SE Linux aware. Everybody remembers chmod and chgroup and chown and all like that. If you wanted to change the context of a file, you can use either chown or setfiles. There's also restorecon to restore context back to what's based on the policy. There are various programs for managing and creating modules that need to be SE Linux aware, and we will talk about some of these. Now this next slide, I struggled with where to put this one in. It needs to be put in, but I didn't know where to put it in, so I figured this is as good a place as any. And this is what I call context hell. This is this is how you can get yourself into context hell. With move and copy, and they do things differently. Okay, if you move a file from one place to another in SELinux, it maintains the original context of the file. So, if you are root, or let's say you're a standard user, you're your user, and you're editing a copy of etcresolve.conf, and you make a change to it. So now you sudo su to root, and you moved that copy of etcresolve.conf from your user home directory into etc. And then you restart your network, and you find your network doesn't work. And you're wondering why. The reason probably why is that the context of your user got maintained when you moved the file across. Just like with permissions. You move a file, the permissions stay the same. You move a file with an SELinux context, the context stays the same. That can give you problems. CP works a little differently. If you're copying the file over and the file already exists, the context remains the same as the destination file. If it doesn't exist, it gets its context based on the directory above it. I don't know how many times I've fallen into this trap. So this is why I put this in here. This is what I call move versus copy, context hell, and how you can get yourself into trouble. And you think, well, gee, this should work. But it doesn't, because the context is all wrong. Okay. You can also use dash Z to set the context explicitly. Okay. Let's talk about SELinux modes. SELinux has three modes of operation: good, better, best. Well, not quite. Disabled. This is the one everybody knows, because people, as soon as they install it, what do? They go in and they set it to disabled, and life is good, right? Wrong. Okay. This is the one that everybody's familiar with. Permissive mode is really what you should be. If you feel that things are not working right, don't turn SELinux off and set it to be disabled. Set it to permissive. Permissive keeps the labeling engine going, so things keep getting labeled. When you disable SELinux, things don't get labeled anymore. This can cause you problems later on if you ever decide to go back into enforcing mode, which we will talk about in a moment. But if you're in enforcing mode, if you're in, pardon me, permissive mode, files still get labeled. They get the right labels. The SELinux policy module still looks at the context and the domains that are coming across, looks at them, but doesn't do anything. It goes ahead and lets access go on anyway if DAC says it's okay. But the main thing is that things are still getting labeled. The other thing that's happening is that you get messages stuffed away in var log, audit, dlog, or syslog if you don't have audit d going, that you have what are called AVC messages, access vector cache messages. And then there's enforcing. This is the one everybody regrets. Because at this point, things are still getting labeled. The policy engine inside of the kernel is looking at the labels and contexts of domains and processes and files, and denying access if it doesn't like what it sees. And of course, you still get logging of the AVC messages. Okay. If you want to see what mode you're in and you're not sure, as it is with most things in Linux, you can either do the get enforce command, which will tell you either disabled, permissive, enabled, enforcing, or SE status, which gives you a little bit more information. How about setting up SE Linux? Well, if you're starting from scratch, and you're starting with, say, RHEL or CentOS or Fedora or something based on one of those, SE Linux is enabled by default, and you may never know it. And as my Brit friend says, you just do the installation and Bob's your uncle. All set to go. That's probably not the case for most of us in here. Probably you have not set up SE Linux and you have been running in disable mode and you decide, you're for various reasons, you decide, okay, I'm going to bite the bullet and I am going to start running SE Linux in a more restrictive environment. Well, your first step is you need to edit the file /etc/selinux-config and look for some lines like this. Change the lines that says disable to permissive and make sure you're running targeted environment. I highly recommend that you don't go for more restrictive environments than targeted, because that will get you most of what you need. Now, if you really are brave, you can, instead of saying permissive here, you can say enforcing. I highly recommend you don't do that. You will have the peasants with torches and pitchforks at your door ready to slay you, because you are the evil genius and you've created a monster. Okay. You've been running in disable mode. You got all these files that don't have labels on them. They need to be relabeled. How do you do that? Easy. Just touch that file. /auto-relabel and reboot. System will go down, it will come back up, and then you will get this message about relabeling. And you'll get a little progress bar as it goes across. It usually doesn't take too long, unless you have hundreds of terabytes of files. This is a critical step. I've forgotten this, and it didn't work. So make sure you touch auto-relabel. How does it know how to relabel things? There are rules in the policy that give some general idea about how things should be relabeled. So, consequently, you may not have things with exactly the right label as a result of this. But now at least you're in permissive mode, and you're getting messages. Yes, sir?
I don't know if you're going to touch on this at some other point in time. If we have a production server or something that does have a zero downtime requirement where we would like to implement this, is there a means to go about that implementation without the reboot, or is the reboot simply required?
I don't know of a way to not to get around that, because you've got to go through that relabel step. And something that I should point out is that what state you can go to from another state in SE Linux, those three states, is sort of determined by what state you're currently in. For instance, if you're in permissive mode, you can go to enforcing mode, and you can go from enforcing mode back to permissive mode. But if you're disabled, you can't go anywhere. You can't go to permissive, because things aren't properly labeled. So it's not like I can be in disable mode and just say, oh, okay, I'm going to bite the bullet. I'm going to go to enforcing mode. Nope. It's a state transition matrix of what you can and you can't go through. But if you're in enforcing mode or permissive mode, you can go back and forth between those two. But if you're in disabled, there's no hope for you. Your only way you're going to get out of that is to do a reboot and change the mode that way. Yes, sir.
I know when you described the enforcing modes earlier,
mm-hmm.
There was disabled and permissive. If you set permissive mode on,
mm-hmm.
have you ever experienced like that breaking anything just because of putting labels on that?
The theory says is that it shouldn't make a difference. Sometimes it does, but generally speaking, no. Yeah. Sometimes it does break things. As I was pointing out to a guy in the lunch line earlier, Oracle is not a friend of SE Linux. SE Linux and Oracle don't get along. In fact, Oracle says the first thing you need to do is turn it, set it in disable mode, not even permissive. They say turn it off. Part of the reason on that is that Oracle, in order to optimize some of their code, does some things that are of questionable programming characteristics. For instance, using trampoline code to make things faster, where they'll push code on the stack and then execute that. Bad, very bad. SE Linux prevents you from doing that. Although you can, if you feel that you want to do that, you can enable that feature. And we'll see how that works a little bit. Okay, you've rebooted. And now you are in permissive mode. And the messages are going to that file, var log audit, audit.log. Okay. You want to see what these messages look like, you can use this command to see the error messages. And this is the part where I can be self-aggrandizing. I am giving a presentation tomorrow on the Linux audit framework. And we will discuss the AU search command. So 11 o'clock tomorrow, be there, be square. This says, show me the access vector cache misses, interpret them for me, and I'm only interested in the failures. I'm not interested in the positive results. Okay, if you're trying to resolve an SE Linux problem, it comes down to four possibilities. Maybe there's a fifth one, but here's four I know of. Wrong subject context. Wrong object context. Right subject and object context, but no access. And lastly, intrusion attempt. We will only be dealing with the first three. If you have this one, that's your problem. You have another problem. I should point out that that file up there, audit.log, is just a plain text file. I do not recommend just looking at it because, for one thing, the timestamp is in epoch format, which I don't understand. I can't do that conversion in my head. There's also a lot of things in it that are, you need the I option to interpret it. Okay, let's look at this first one. The program is running with the wrong subject context. Okay, why does this happen? Sometimes you install a program and this an executable, and it ends up with the wrong context. This is usually happen when you start installing some third-party software. This happened to me when I was installing the NMAP program, network map. I installed it and it ended up with some really off-the-wall context, and when Nessus tried running it, it didn't run. So I managed to track it down and I found out that the Nessus, that NMAP, did not have the right type of context on it. So I found out what that context needed to be. And then I set it with the change context command. Change context type equals, and for some reason it needs to be traceroute exec type, and the file name. Do an ls-c to make sure that it's okay. And sure enough, traceroute exec type. I could also do the same thing with the SEManage command. SEManage file context add the type traceroute underscore exec type nmap.
Question?
Yes, sir.
How do you figure out what type it should be?
In this particular case, Google. Okay. In this particular case, Google, because somebody else was having the same problem and I found it that way. Another way is LSJC. Let's look at the file. Other file, let's say you have a file in user bin. User bin's a good one. You do an LSJC of that particular file and you see what its context is, and then look at what the other context, what the context of other files in user bin are. And probably it's not the same. That's the way I found best so far. Yes, sir.
Is there a help or a cache or a documentation or something that lists all of those types and all possible entries that can be there?
We're coming to that. Good lead-in. We're coming to that. Okay. A wrong object context. This is a file that doesn't have the right type of context on it. Once again, third-party software installs it and inherits the context from the upper-level directory. That may not be what it's expecting. A lot of time, and this is where you can do the ls-z to see what the context is. And usually, you want the context of, you will probably want the context of the program and the file to match. A lot of times what happens is that lazy system administrators change a configuration file and they move it across rather than copying it. There's any number of ways to respond to this. You can use the change context, or you can use this utility called restore configuration, in which case SELinux will look at the policy and see what that file should probably be based on the policy rules that are built into the targeted environment policy. Again, ls-z is your friend. Okay. Number three, door number three. Your context is okay on your program. The context is okay on your file, but access still doesn't work. This is the dreaded part. You're going to have to modify the policy. Oh no. Policy modification. Run for the hills. Okay. In earlier versions of SELinux, you're probably going to have to write some policy. But they've made it easier for you with this concept called SELinux Booleans. And there's a whole bunch of SELinux Booleans. Usually their value is either on or off. There's probably an SELinux Boolean associated with a service that's not working. There's a whole lot of them for HTTPD. Okay, well, what's an SELinux Boolean? Minor modifications, rather than having to write a whole policy and having to compile the policy and insert it in there and test it, the bright guys, primarily Dan Walsh, Mr. SELinux, came up with this idea of Booleans so that we can, while the system is running, you can flip bits on and off within the policy and make some changes without having to do lots of work and write policy. For example, you may want to have allow Apache to be able to address and look into the user's public directory underneath their home directory. There is an SELinux Boolean that you can flip on or off to allow this, and by default it is off. So Booleans are just that. They're just Boolean values. But as with lots of things, they got extended, and now they can actually have values beyond Booleans. If you want to find out what all the Booleans are, you can use the get SELinux Boolean command dash A, and it will list them all out. And I highly recommend you also pipe that into more, because there's a lot of them. You can, and as I said, there's more than one way to do anything in Linux. You can also use the SEManage command, boolean dash L. I prefer to use SEManage. I prefer to use this command because it will produce this nice alphabetized list of all of the Booleans. It will tell you what its default state is, what its current state is, and probably more importantly, it'll gives you a short sentence that says what it's good for. I like this one. This saves me a lot of trouble. For instance, you want to enable Apache to be able to read users' home directories. Here's the command you'd use. Set seboolean httpd enable home dirs on. That turns it on. That only turns it on for the running system. If you wanted to make it permanent across reboots, you do the dash P. So that way, it gets actually shoved back into the policy rather than just into the running policy engine. And it will exist across reboots. Let's say that you get a new application in-house and it says, oh, well, you need to run Apache on port 8080. And you think, fine, no problem. And you start it up and it doesn't work. Well, it turns out that within the policy module for targeted environment, Apache is defined to only work on 80 and 443. Anything else, you get an access violation, it doesn't work. You can change that port value. SEManage port add type HTTP port type protocol TCP port number. Bingo. Now your application will work. There's a whole bunch of things like that that have values rather than just on and off. And again, SEManage will get you those. Now we get to the really interesting part. Sometimes it's just necessary to create a new policy module. It just happens that way. I've had to do that a lot. Now, you have adjusting the context of the object. You have adjusting the context of the executable. You have SEBooleans. I presented them in that way because that's the way you should approach this. What I'm about to tell you with audit to allow should be one of your last tricks. Do not automatically reach for audit to allow. If that's your first thing out of your toolkit to fix policy, you're going about it the wrong way. You're also making work for yourself. Okay. You're in permissive mode, and you're generating all of these error messages about things that can't be accessed. Wouldn't it be great if you could take all of those error messages and turn that into policy so that you didn't have to figure out what was wrong? Great tool. Audit to allow takes those access vector cache, AVC error messages, and turns them into policy for you. But as I said before, don't reach for this tool first. Look at the context, look at Booleans first. And in fact, audit to allow has gotten smart enough now that if it thinks there is a Boolean that you can set to correct your problem and not generate a policy module, it will tell you this. So don't just create policy. Look for other ways to fix it first. And the nice thing about it is it generates syntactically correct type enforcement stuff. Hopefully, this will be enough to prevent further denials. Here's one way you can use it. Audit to allow taking from the var r audit, audit.log file. I do not recommend this at all for a couple of different reasons. One is that you're going to get a resulting policy file out of this. It's going to have every kind of allow statement in the world to make it, to change the policy. We don't write one big ginormous program anymore. We use functional decomposition to create functions. You should apply that same methodology to the creation of policy modules. Only create a policy module for a specific instance of a program or a specific instance of your access denial. A much better way to do it is like this. I use search to get the stuff out. I want to match against access vector caches. I want successes. I want failures, pardon me. Time start. If you come to my thing on audit tomorrow, you'll learn that AU search understands this wonderful time called recent, which means 5 minutes ago. Hey, I wish other things understood the idea of recent, but whose idea of recent is what? And you pipe that into audit to allow, and it comes out, it'll show you on your screen the rules that would get rid of this for the last 5 minutes. Using that idea of functional decomposition, I am interested in this program called Prelude Manager. I just picked that one. I would use this command to narrow it down because grep can be your friend. All of this stuff, I'm interested in the matching the AVCs, I'm interested in the failures 5 minutes ago, and I grep for that to section out only the things associated with Prelude Manager and pipe that into audit to allow. And that'll generate my policy. Or show me what it looks like. You can get rid of this step and say, I am only interested in things of Prelude Manager type. And it will match against that particular type. Okay. SE Linux is all about
labels.
Good. I had an English teacher that if she thought people were sleeping, she'd make everybody stand up and do jumping jacks. I'm not that bad. Okay. You see the policy come by and you think, well, okay, this looks pretty good. Let's turn this into a real policy module. Now, a little note about policy modules. When you name them, module names, I can start, they must begin with a letter. It can be followed by letters, numbers, dashes, underscores, or periods. This is not the way it used to be. It used to be you're stuck with letters and numbers. They made a great leap forward by allowing something else, some nice characters in there to delimit things off. So, let's generate that module source file. So I do AU search and I match against AVC and I'm interested in things that fail and it's recent and I'm interested in the NERPY type, which is associated with Nagios. NERPY is the daemon that runs. And I pipe that into audit to allow, and I give it a module name with the dash M, and I call it Doctor Who NERPY, and I put it to a file. Now, a suggestion. When you create the module name here. Don't just call it NERPY, because more than likely there's already a policy there called NERPY. I like to put the node name on it. That way I don't flop on top of a policy module that might already be loaded. You could also say local NERPY or something, but just something to distinguish it from being anything that might be shipped with it as part of the normal policy. And this is what that policy file looks like. This is an actual source policy file. I wish I had a laser pointer. See that number up there, 1.0? That got automatically generated. Yes, thank you. That number got automatically generated by audit to allow, and that is can be a version number. Unfortunately, audit to allow does not increment this every time you generate a new policy. I highly recommend that as you add to the file with more policy statements, you increment that number so that you can keep track of what is going on. And with the new latitude on names and numbers, I just increment it by a tenth every time. But change that number. If you have to add more stuff to this, change that number so that you can keep up with what's really going on. But it's sort of a pseudo-programming language. We have a type called NERPY type, and we have a type called RPM var lib type, and a class called direct research, and then it generates comment, and it says, allow, that's the big word. Everything is allow pretty much all the time because the default policy is to deny. Deny, allow NERPY type to search a directory called RPM var lib type. That's what that means. It's, you know, C syntax is a little bit backwards, and this is sort of like C. So what that does, like I say, this says allow anything with a NERPY type to search a directory that's RPM var lib type. Because what Nagios does is it starts off a process on your system, at least the way we have it set up, that does an RPM command to see if the version of the kernel has changed. Well, ordinarily NERPY doesn't have permission to read this particular directories with this particular type of label. So that grants that access. Okay, we got source. We got source. Okay, now what we do is we turn it into a policy module of binary stuff. Then we use the check module command for that. We write it out to the NERPY module, and there's the source file. So now we have the binary representation of that source. So now what we need to do is we need to go a step further, and we need to turn it into what's called a policy module, and this PP on the end. As near as I can figure, PP stands for policy profile. Okay. The SE module package writes out, takes in a module file, that's that binary, and turns it into a policy profile. Okay. We're there. We've got our new policy module. And now we need to get it into the kernel. SE module install file name. Bingo. And it goes away for a while. This is not an inconsiderable short-term thing. It will take a while because the engine has to get everything set up when you put that new policy module in. To me, this looks very suspiciously like developing a device driver. You compile, you link, and you load it into the kernel. Now, if this policy module doesn't do what you think it does, you can get rid of it by saying remove, and away it goes. It's not there anymore. But I think this is very suspiciously like doing a device driver. Okay. All your problems are through. You don't have any more AVC messages. Wonderful. That was easy. Wish that were the case in real life. So now we're ready to go to enforcing mode. As it is with anything in Linux, there is more than one way to do it. If you are in permissive mode, all you have to do is root is say set enforce forcing. Poof. And now we are in enforcing mode. Well, maybe you didn't quite get everything. Maybe some things aren't working. You're still getting AVC messages. A couple of things you could do. You could go back to permissive mode and do more debugging by just saying set enforce permissive. You're still getting all the labeling. The policy engine is looking at the labels and the context and making decisions, but it's not, nothing's happening. Or you can use this wonderful new feature called the permissive domains. Rather than go back into permissive mode and perhaps leave your system vulnerable, you can make certain domains act in permissive mode, but everything but the system itself continues to run in enforcing mode. That particular domain generates the access violations. They go into a file. You can go back and run audit to allow some more, see if you can correct them. A couple of ways you can do this: SEManage, permissive, add NERPY type. That sets that particular domain to being permissive. The rest of the system is in enforcing mode, but NERPY is generating error messages and it's just going through. You can turn it off with the dash D, and that says, oh, this permissive domain is no longer permissive. If you want to find out what all of your permissive domains are, SEManage permissive dash list. And it will list all of the permissive domains. This is one of the great new features in SELinux, because now you don't have to make the whole system permissive. You can just make a few domains permissive, or maybe just the domain that's giving you a big headache permissive while you go back and you debug it. Okay. Gee, I've gotten ahead of myself, and this is basically what I was going to say. You're still getting denials logged. You don't have to decrease the security profile of your system by going back into full permissive mode. Just the domain that you're interested in or domains that are giving you headaches are put into permissive mode without making the whole system at risk.
Just to give a simple example, so you install the SELinux, somebody wants to run nmap, what would be the default? Would that be the flag or that would be allowed?
That's a subject context. The reason I chose NERPY is because that's my current problem. For this bit on permissive domains, because I've got policy generated for NERPY, but I'm getting no AVC messages, but it still doesn't run. I don't know what's wrong. I got to go back and do some more serious debugging. But I can still get all the benefits of Nagios by making the domain permissive and letting it run.
Are you sure it's SELinux?
Because
if you've got a firewall against UDP, that could be it.
It runs otherwise, right?
It runs otherwise. If I put it into a permissive domain, it runs perfectly.
Okay.
So the thing that's eating me alive is that I'm not getting any AVC messages. So this is, pardon?
It's because it's going against the don't audit policy.
Yeah.
SEManage dash capital D dash capital D capital B. That'll turn off don't audit, and then you can run it and you'll get more verbose auditing and figure it out.
Thank you. Let's see. Okay. One last thing before you go to enforcing mode. You may have some processes out there, demons that are not running in any kind of reasonable context. A lot of times this is not so good because you may be getting ABC denials as a result and it's not running. It may have more privileges than you really need. Case in point, my Nessus stuff. They do not supply a policy module. I have asked them about this and they have said, we may get to this in a future release. So, if you want to know what daemons are not confined to a domain, this wonderful command will run, and if it just comes back with nothing, you're in great shape. You don't have any unconfined daemons, but if it comes back with a number, it means you've got some daemons that are running in an unconfined space. What this does, ps-ez, show me all the context, look for initrc, which is the context of init, and then some other stuff to strip some stuff out, pipe that into awk, and then it prints out the number of fields, and if it doesn't print anything out, you're good to go, but if you get a number, that's how many you got. These are my unconfined domain, unconfined daemons on my Nessus server. Making it a way of life, change, edit the etc, config, compile, change permissive to enforcing, reboot. A one-stop shopping place for everything that I've been able to find about SELinux is in this one place. It's got gobs of stuff.
Let's go back to the previous slide for a second.
Sure. You want to get that command, right?
Yeah.
That's it? Yeah, it took me a while to work this one out. Yeah.
I like it.
Yep. You don't often see TRUs very much.
You don't need it. You do minus capital F on awk.
Yeah, you can do it that way too. That's the wonderful thing about Linux.
More than one way.
There's more than one way to do it. If you want to get back to the source, the NSA is the progenitor of SELinux. They have recently done something SE for Android. Yep. Okay. As Porky Pig says, that's all, folks. There's my email address. Now, this came out pretty good. I was afraid I was going to go over. Okay, questions. I'm sure there's tons. Yes, sir.
You mentioned altering the version as you were going through the policies.
Right, the lather, rinse, repeat loop, yes.
Yes. Are those policies, as they're being stored, are they stored in some sort of a differential manner such that typing that out is worthwhile, or do you need to instantiate those again in SVN or something like that to track your own history?
That's mostly for my own purposes.